Moving on now to the 10-year SOFII celebration. I'm turning this part of the meeting over to Sarah.
Now on to the fun stuff. Thank you for your patience. We are so excited to be celebrating the 10-year SOFII today with our three speakers. I'm going to ask Wendy Timpano, a board member, to come up, talk a little bit about SOFII, and then we're going to go into our success panel. So I hope you really enjoy our celebration that we have for you.
Thanks, Sarah. Good morning, everyone. And this really is the fun stuff. I think I have the best job this morning, getting to talk to these successful and interesting people over here. So it is a privilege and an honor to be asked to be part of this part of the morning, celebrating 10 years of the Southern Ontario Fund for Investment in Innovation, or SOFII, as everybody knows. It really is exciting. I do remember, Linda mentioned, being there at the beginning, and I did sit around that table where we were talking about the development of the program, and it is so hard to believe it's 10 years already. But it is amazing to have now witnessed the success and the impact that it has had on many of the businesses and clients that have accessed that program. So thank you for the opportunity to come up here and share on this 10th anniversary. So SOFII, the vision for SOFII was to encourage innovation while easing the transition in Southern Ontario from a manufacturing-based economy to a knowledge-based economy. And the fund began as a $12 million contribution from FedDev Ontario. Through additional tranches, that has increased now to $25 million. And I know that Linda also shared some stats there at the beginning about some of the impact that it has had. I will also add to that, we have had $46 million approved, $36 million advanced to businesses, and that $46 million is applications from over 100 businesses that have been approved. So it's actually really great to see how the volume of access that people have actually taken advantage of this fund. And I do want to say, none of this would be possible, of course, without the volunteers, the staff. Like, there are so many people who are involved in this program, and of course FedDev as well. And I do want to ask for your patience, because I do want to mention a few people. I know that Sarah's gone through some thank yous, and Linda went through some thank yous, and Barb has, but it really is important, I think, to thank the people who have been involved. And And so I do want to mention a few names. So first of all, of course, the volunteers who sit around the committee, they have excellent backgrounds that are valuable and critical to analyzing those loan applications that come through. Want to mention a few of those names, or all of the names of the people who sit on the committee currently. And so George Miller, Deanna Sandrin, Earl Mays, Richard Fanning, Bob Ashcroft, Judy Lamb, Jeff Kinsella, and Jim Hunter. So thank you so much to those volunteers who contribute their time. They meet multiple times a month to review the applications and really do help quite a bit. I also want to thank our corporate lawyers, Peter Norris from George Murray Shipley Bell and Pamela Norris at Harrison Pensa. Of course, to the experienced staff at WOCF, all past and present who have contributed to the fund, had such an impact on the businesses, as I noted before. Specifically, would like to thank Jerry McAhone and Richard Irwin. And then I also did want to also thank the board members who have had a role to play in providing guidance and stewardship over the last 10 years for the SOFII program. So thank you as well. And last but of course not least, FedDev Ontario, for the support that you provide to the fund on an ongoing basis and helping us with that vision to create such a program for Southern Ontario. So thank you very much. You know, it's no surprise. Of course, we all know that there have been many challenges over the last couple of years. And our portfolio companies have certainly had to battle through those challenges through the COVID pandemic. And, you know, they've faced resulting supply chain disruptions. There's current semiconductor shortages that are impacting our Internet of Things companies, various things that they've had to face. But fortunately, SOFII's been able to assist many of them, needing the help that they needed with the transition to a more stable economy. And so we'll look forward to continuing that work in Southern Ontario. Especially in turbulent times, this Sustainable Fund is there to support the innovation ecosystem. So as we continue to work with new applicants, we're amazed at the incredible levels of innovation and discovery that are coming out of their persistent efforts in their unyielding pursuit of success. We're proud of each of our portfolio companies, past and present, and the incredible levels of achievement they have earned. And we, as a group, collectively, can be proud of the small role that we've played in their success. And at this point, this is the really fun part. I'm going to shift over to this chair over here, and we'll have a discussion with these three individuals over here. We have with us today, we have Sunil Selby, who's from Datec Coatings. So Sunil, give us a wave there. Brittany Maksymyk, and right there in the middle, she's with Plum.io. Some of us experienced the work that she's doing. And Tristian Lehair, who is with TritionWear here on the end. So I will be right back. So thank you again for being with us and taking the time to share your experience with SOFII. It will be great, I think, for a lot of people in the room. I mean, sometimes we sit around the board table and we hear of the names and some of the great work that companies like yourselves are doing. And so this is really an exciting opportunity for us to hear directly from you. I'll ask the first question. I mean, introduce yourself if you would. Tell us a little bit about what your company is and does. Sunil, let's start with you. We'll start at this end.
Good morning, and thanks for inviting us to be part of this celebration. So my name is Sunil Selby, and I want to put one thing on the table, which is that the CEO of the company is a business partner of mine. His name is Dominic Talala, and some of you may have dealt with him. He is actually in Ireland right now, so he asked if I would fill in. I do know enough about the company because we are investors in the company, and we sit on their board, and that's our model. So we don't just invest in companies, or at least some of them. We actually actively operate them or play a part of their management team. Please forgive me if I, inaccurately give information that is on your files. just as I said, I have a venture capital and private equity fund called Trellis Capital that I created many years ago. Dominic joined me 5 years after we had done it. So I'm dating myself, but we started it in the year 2000. So we've been at it for quite a long time. We don't do lots of deals, but we do a few. So right now we have 10. We've exited well in some. I will not claim that we've had any losses, which is totally a lie. Datec has been very special because Dominic runs it, and therefore we know it quite well. He knows it the best. I do sit on their board, so keep it honest and keep SOFII money intact, hopefully, and well used.
That's great.
So that's sort of a little bit of my background, and I don't want to hog the limelight. So, yeah. Oh, and Datec, if you wanted me to just finish off the story on what it does. So Datec is a materials technology company. So the company has created sol gel materials, which falls under the family of thick film, which is separate from nanofilm, but it has a variety of applications. It's very strongly patented. Materials technologies, if people know, have a lot of applications, and the danger can be that you go after everything. Fortunately, we were able to focus on a few applications, and at some point I'll go further into sort of, you know, where do we use it, and how did we use the you know, the SOFII money and so on.
Yeah, that sounds excellent. Yeah, I'm sure that the audience is looking forward to hearing that part of it as well. So let's move on. Thank you for coming, though, and let's go over to Brittany.
Hi, everyone. Aren't EGMs fun? Super fun, right? Super energizing. So my name is Brittany. I've been with Plum for 6 years now. I'm the VP of Finance at Plum. Caitlin, our CEO, she's actually in Vegas accepting Best HR Product of the Year at HR Tech in Vegas, so she sent me instead. So my background's obviously in accounting. What Plum does is we really help enterprise clients with the quality of their hire, so really matching people with roles in the job. And so you guys all, or some of you, got to experience Plum yesterday, so you know, we believe in a world where every single person can be matched with the right role, and they're really thriving, and they want to get up, and they want to work every day, and they want to be excited about what they do. So that's kind of the world we're thriving towards, trying to really flip an industry, a traditionally old HR industry, which, you know, makes talent decisions based on subjective data, biased data. We're trying to really implement scientific data using years and years of industrial organizational psychology, and really use that data to make the best talent decisions within your organization.
Great, thanks, Brittany. And Tristian.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tristian Lehair, founder and CEO of TritionWear. We're a wearable technology company where we're really trying to unlock athlete potential through the power of data. So basically, our technology automates data collection for swimmers and triathletes, and then basically we analyze that data automatically through our AI-based auto-coaching tools to really show athletes exactly where they can focus to improve, whether that's their skills, training intensity, or readiness to train. So, you know, we've been working with SOFII, I think, since 2015, so for quite a while now, I think before we shipped our first product. And now we work with, you know, thousands of athletes around the world in 60-plus countries, from grassroots beginners up to Olympic gold medalists. I think at the top end, we work with over 30 national Olympic federations. And at the Tokyo Olympics last year, I think we had 67 Olympians qualify with the help of our technology. And they brought home 24 Olympic medals, so that was pretty exciting and great validation at the top end of our technology.
That's very exciting. Yeah, thanks for sharing that. Excellent. So I'm going to start with you, Brittany, for this next question. Wondering how the funding received through the SOFII program has helped the business grow.
Yeah, for sure. So really three main areas, I would say, that it's really, really, we've really benefited from. We are a VC-backed company, so we burn cash, and we're expected to have really high growth rates, being that VC-backed. So the best thing that SOFII does, or has done, we started their loan, I think, in 2018, and actually, just September, we just increased our loan back up to the original amount. So SOFII was super great with working with us and with that. So we're going out for our Series A fundraising, and really what it helps us to do is lengthen our runway. Obviously, coming from a position of power, the longer runway we have, we can negotiate with some of these VCs and get the best deal possible, increase our valuation, and really it just puts us in a really strong position, having that lengthened runway. So that's one of the main things, being a VC-backed company. The second would be talent. We're always trying to compete for talent. Based in Waterloo, there's lots of tech companies there. And so having that little bit of extra capital has really been able to, we've been able to compete and bring on some really, really strong talent to help us grow. And then the third thing I would say is kind of indirect. I would say just being a part of kind of the SOFII, FedDev, BDC, EDC ecosystem. I would say 2 years ago, most of our revenue was from the US. And over the past kind of 2 years, just by the exposure, some of the press coverage, some of the great work all of the government, you know, as a whole, all of the government funding has been doing for us, I think we're almost matching our Canadian revenue now with our US revenue. So I would say that's probably one of the less frequently talked about benefits, but we've really benefited from, you know, all of the government funding as a whole really working together.
Excellent. Great. Thanks. Sunil, yeah. How about you? Same question about funding and
right.
Benefits.
So we got our first funding in 2013, if I remember correctly. And Essentially, it was to scale up the material, what we call the paste technology. So it was lab scale, and we needed to make sure that you could do it in, you know, production kind of scale. So we got the loan for that very specifically, and what it really did was, A, helped us make sure that we could scale up, but not only that, we were able to attract a large, which has become a customer as well, but a strategic investor. So it's a company called EGO out of Germany that is very big in appliances, you know, for cooktops and so on, which is very useful for our technology. So once we were able to demonstrate that this technology is large scale production worthy, we were able to get them not only interested to be a customer, but basically to invest a sizable amount.
Excellent. Congratulations. Tristan?
Yeah, for sure. I think I'll phrase this in terms of not just money, but in terms of general support. I think as a hardware company, you know, we naturally deal with a lot of expenses that are maybe not the best use of maybe venture capital. And we do have venture capital money, but we don't necessarily want to buy inventory with venture capital. It's a kind of a waste of equity. So I think from our side of things, that's always been a big help of funds like SOFII, is to help us, you know, have that working capital to buy more inventory, get ahead of it, get good pricing, make sure we don't run out of units when we're growing really quickly, especially nowadays when we're dealing with the supply chain situation that we're dealing with. So that's been really helpful for us. I would say that's probably one of the main things we ended up leveraging it for. But then I think just in general in support, it's been super helpful the last few years, especially. I think during COVID, we had a couple of branches of directions companies went. Either companies did really well during COVID or somewhat okay, and companies that got hit really, really hard during COVID. I think because we, you know, we leverage facilities for athletes, for training, all of our facilities basically shut down when COVID came in, so our customers shut down too. So, you know, we basically saw, I think, over 12 months, like an 80% revenue drop because of COVID, and SOFII was a huge support during that, helping us, whether it was defer principal or what have you, to help us, you know, manage those kind of challenging times and not make it a cookie cutter thing for us that they did for other companies, but just support us in a way that hit, you know, really fit us, I think. And that was great for us because we basically managed to not only not have to lay anybody off, it allowed us to really come back quickly. So when our market started to recover earlier this year, you know, we've been able to hit the ground running with growth, and we're going to be back past our pre-COVID revenue within 12 months. So that's been really, really helpful for us.
Yeah, that's excellent. Yeah, no question. COVID certainly has caused some unique situations, and I think every business is unique in terms of what they've had to face and deal with. Just a follow up to that question in terms of business growth, has employment, you know, with the funding that SOFII's provided, have you been able to generate, you know, more employment jobs in terms of your growth, or any of you?
Yeah, I would say COVID definitely hit us hard too. People stopped hiring all around the world. So with that, we were also able, like SOFII funding, SOFII was great by letting us defer some principal payments as well. We were able to maintain our whole staff through that. And I think we've added 10 or 12 new people since coming out of COVID. So SOFII,
that's great.
You know, huge support there.
Excellent.
Yeah, I'd say we're in the same boat. Yeah, we managed to maintain our whole staff, and now coming out of that, we're able to continue scaling, and I think we're adding 3 or 4 bodies in the next month, and we're about to close another financing round that let us get there, really, because we had these kind of supports from SOFII and other groups.
Yeah, same for us. So we were able to keep our employees through COVID, and you know, as it's coming out, there's growth more, so we are hiring quite a few. I do want to add one thing is, we were able to pay back the first loan, and we got a second one just early this year. So, you know, if it's really a, you know, the money came in really useful for us, and therefore did what it had to do. So the second loan is being used now for actually a particular application, a warming application that is has got sort of disruptive potential with our strategic investor for appliances. You know, I'll keep it at that. It's sort of under wraps, but it will make a huge difference in terms of what it can do. So, you know, employment will go up. We're fairly automated, so we don't have big numbers. We're about 20 people, but it's all automated, so it does what it has to do.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit about business process improvements and, you know, in terms of your application to SOFII. Do you want to start, Tristian? How about that?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, when we first applied in 2015, we were a pretty young company. I think we were founded in 2014, so I think our processes were pretty, you know, rough around the edges, to say the least, when we first started. So I think it was great. I mean, I think going through that process, you know, really gets your data room and everything in line, and really gets you keeping your things aligned over time. So yeah, I think it was a great experience for us. It got us prepared for, you know, other money we take on later in our kind of pathway, as well as venture capital down the road from that. So yeah, I think in general, you know, definitely helped us keep things in line, make sure that our, you know, financial statements and everything were on track, and always, you know, at least review engagement and make sure that we're doing well there. But yeah, make sure we have really, really good records and know what we're talking about on our data and our metrics. And yeah, I think it was in general a great experience for us in the early days.
Great. Brittany, do you want to go next?
Well, Caitlin had me as a finance person, so I think we had worked with FedDev in the past, which was actually super, really prepared us for, you know, we kind of had our data room set up and had some previous seed funding. So the application process was actually quite straightforward for us in 2018. Now, that being said, the more eyes you can get on your data, the better. The more feedback you can get, the more. So it really just, again, helped us for VC raising later. You know, tweak this, change this. What about a question on this? You know, the more people that can look at your stuff, the better. The other thing I would say was it enforced us to have key person insurance. So our two founders are married, they travel together, obviously a risk from a governance side of the company. And so that was something we really didn't think about before SOFII came in. And then it made us look into some of our other insurance policies and kind of just up our insurance to make sure we were covered, which otherwise we probably wouldn't have done.
Yeah, it's great to hear that, you know, the application process and just the help from staff can help you think about things that you might not have thought of, right? That's great. Sunil?
Yeah, no, the same thing. And it really came in useful. I mean, a lot of it we were doing because, you know, it's venture-backed, and so it's part of what we make sure is happening. But it really came in useful, especially when it came to the data room, because we got, you know, strategic investor funding fairly soon after that. And so, hey, it was quite. We were kept on our toes, and it really, we didn't have to do too much after that. So, very useful.
Excellent. So the next question is: would you or have you actually referred SOFII to anyone in your ecosystem?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think most of my founder friends in Waterloo probably have SOFII funding already. but I definitely spoke with a bunch of them about it when they didn't. I think for me, it's one of the more entrepreneur-friendly kind of environments and groups. Some groups are a little bit less so, and ask a lot for a young company and young founders that don't have a lot going for them besides their company at that stage of their life. So I think for us, it was definitely a great program to support the company, support us personally. At our stages of life, and I think it just works really well in the ecosystem, and I think, yeah, I definitely recommended it to a few.
Excellent. Brittany?
Founder-friendly is a great way to put it. Being in my role, I have evaluated probably over 50 different non-dilutive debt, and SOFII is one of the best ones out there. So both Caitlin and myself, I would say, refer it frequently to other founders, especially the Waterloo Tech is a small ecosystem. Lots of peer-to-peer discussions that we have, and it comes up almost on every peer-to-peer that I'm in, every peer-to-peer that Caitlin, my CEO, is in, through Toronto and Waterloo for sure. And people that leave our organization have also utilized SOFII funding at their new organization. So it's definitely one, word of mouth and founder friendly is definitely helpful.
Excellent. Did you want to add anything?
Yeah, just 2 points. One is that, you know, we are venture capital investors, and so, you know, all our companies, we all, you know, it's, as Brittany said, it's a very friendly, non-dilutive debt instrument and organization, so it helps a lot. So that's 1 point. So we always are telling our founders, because many of them may not know, and it's fear of the unknown more than anything else. So the more familiar they get, and you know, the referrals make a big difference. So that's one. And the second point, just when I came this morning, I talked to Sarah, and for the company that I manage, we are going to talk about it. So hey, what more testimony do you want?
Excellent. Thank you so much. So, you know, feedback is critical, of course, as you know, as you're, you know, in your own companies there and in the business. But it's also important for us at SOFII. So I'm wondering if this is one of our final questions here before we open it up to the floor for questions of you. But just wondering if you have anything you wanted to share with us in terms of feedback for the SOFII program specifically that we can take back.
I can jump in. Yeah, I mean, I'd say, I mean, on the positive side for sure, I'd say keep being flexible, work with founders. I think there's always, there's not a cookie cutter, one size fits all for every company. And I think that's one of the things that's really unique about SOFII is that they work with you based on your situation, based on your market, based on kind of what you expect to see in the coming, you know, coming period. So I think that's awesome. I don't think there's many groups that do that from a debt perspective. So that's been great. I'd say on the other side, you know, I think as a young tech company, time is always of the essence, so you're always running as fast as you can, and a week for us is like a lifetime. So I'd say always, you know, the faster you can get deals done for people, that's always going to be beneficial. So just, you know, one piece of feedback that I think would be good for founders.
Yeah, that's great great feedback. That is can be a challenge because it you know, it's a bit of a process through the application and working through it, but definitely good feedback that we can consider for sure.
You almost stole my answer there. but yeah, I was going to say something similar. It's as much as like both all government funding is, first of all, it's hard to find sometimes what am I eligible for, what am I not, especially through COVID. There were so many different things. It's almost like it was my full-time job just to be looking at different funding options. So the more marketing I think that you guys can do to say like, here's who we're targeting with this specific fund so that it's very clear, or else, you know, someone needs a staff to be able to dig through and find out, should we apply for this, should we not? And then the more you can streamline application and processing time, because, you know, lots of things to do, not a lot of time, not a lot of resources and staff at some of these small organizations, and also not a lot of expertise sometimes. People don't bring finance on very early usually, and so it's usually the founders who are doing some of this stuff, and it's not their, you know, not their main job. They're kind of doing it on the side of their desk. So the more, I think, you know, the more marketing and the more streamlined the process can be, the better.
Yeah, excellent. Definitely gives us some stuff to work to. I'm guessing if I look around the room here, that's probably not a surprise to many of us who, you know, are in the world of financing. Sunila?
They've spoken pretty much all good, clever answers, so I don't have too much to add. I'd just reiterate a little bit on what Tristian was saying. The more the your staff can understand the, you know, not the details of the business, but more to do what are the operating principles or the dynamics of that particular industry, and therefore where does that fit in? It's useful for us, and it certainly probably is useful for your evaluation of risk. So just that's a little bit to add.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. This has been great. Anything else that you'd like to share today before I open it up to the floor for questions? Is there anything that you just thought you really wanted to shout out to the world? No? Okay, great. Does anybody out here have any questions that they have of the panelists? I'm not sure how much time we have left. We've got a few minutes still, right?
We've got a few minutes to take questions. If anyone in the room has questions, please raise your hand.
Excellent, Alan.
And we'll get a mic runner to you, along with the online audience, if you want to raise your hand.
So we're all coming back after COVID. So what are some of your challenges that you're facing, like post-COVID, you know, whether it's staffing or maybe the way the office is run or who's in the office or out, or and kind of, you know, what do you think the future of the workplace is? Because that's what we're kind of looking at right now. But, and I know you're on the forefront of technology and things like that. So what does your future workplace look like?
Yeah, I mean, I can jump in. It's a long list. We're going to be here a while if we're going to talk about all the challenges. But yeah. But yeah, I think, I mean, for us, the supply chain right now is a big focus. We went from, I was telling these guys that we used to have 8 to 12 week lead times from ordering parts to getting new units in our hands. Now it's 72 weeks. So it's a different world. We have to buy inventory for 2 years worth and hoping our projections are accurate both on the high and low case so we're not caught in a bind with too much inventory and not caught in a bind without inventory. So challenging cash flow situations there. I think the financial markets obviously are challenging, so we're kind of being cognizant of that and being extremely capital efficient, driving to profitability and so on. So I think those are big focuses. At the same time, I think we have a lot of good things going on, and that drives a really strong business if you can make those things work. So for us, I think, yeah, we're in a positive spot in that respect. I think the workforce being remote, you know, we came from a remote background, you know, for quite a long time. Then we were hybrid, then we went back to fully remote. And, I think we're pretty well versed in that. We've always had a company that's been pretty spread out across Waterloo, Toronto, Ottawa, the U.S. now. So it's, you know, it's something you just need to manage and deal with. And I think it's up to each company to decide what's best for them. But for us, you know, I think remote makes a lot of sense and we can get a lot more out of people if you can manage remote really well.
You have a lot of questions in there.
I know, I should have stopped.
So first,
just to try to get something.
I think what our customers are dealing with mostly is retention. So everyone's heard people are leaving, people are going to remote companies, and so the biggest challenge we're trying to help our customers fill is retention. How do you keep the good people? How do you decide? Or with recessions coming up, how do you decide who to keep? If some companies are doing layoffs, and so that I think is going to continue into the future. I think that's the world we're going to live in, where talent is going to be super important, and you can work for any company all over the world. Remote is going to be another big thing that companies are going to have to look into. Now I can work in San Francisco or anywhere from my home, and that there's challenges with that as well. And we just went fully remote. So as of September 1st, we gave up our office. And went fully remote as a company. And you know, what does that look like for all companies all over the world? We'll find out. But I think that's what the future of work looks like.
I would look at it a little bit or maybe add some nuances to what's been said, which is, I think that firstly, regarding what's happened, the best thing that happened in terms of work ethic and expectations has been the fact that everything has gone. We've been forced over the last two and a half years to make sure that everything is output based and deliverable based, rather than time based. So that's been really good because you just were not able to function all the time in person together. So I think that that has become now a way of life, which is very good. In terms of remote versus sort of hybrid and so on. I'd say that it's a little bit more nuanced from the standpoint that it's going to be dependent on industry. It's going to be dependent on what function you play in an organization. And I'll just give it by way of anecdotal evidence. So the company that I manage, we've got 130 employees, of which maybe 40 are developers and product specialists and so on. And we are not able to just have them purely work remote. When you are in a creative environment, you got to collaborate, and a lot of collaborating cannot be done over, video and so on. So now, I don't think it's going to come back to nine to, it will not, I don't think, come back to 9 to 5, 5 days a week. That sort of, it's far gone from that, and there's really no need for that. But I do think that there are jobs in which it's necessary to collaborate. And I also think that, all of us as human beings are social creatures. So you need to have an element of meeting. And prior to this, we were talking about, team events, whatever it is, even if you don't have to do the work on those times, but it is just to get to know your colleagues and so on. So that's sort of the way I see it as to one shoe doesn't fit all. And there'll be what makes sense for an organization. And coming to your point of, the retention of employees and so on, values have changed. Work-life balance, it's not just salary, it's not just, hey, this is the only thing in my life. And so the flexibility to be able to do your work when you want to do your work, but be able to produce the results is so much more right now. Like, we've got people, in the day they're going with their kids somewhere, but they're sitting at 11 in the night, And frankly, who cares, as long as it's getting done. So it's like, I look at it very optimistically for the future.
I was just going to add, I think especially the new generation of people coming up in the workforce, they are thinking about work a lot differently than we have ever previously thought about work. They want a job where they're happy, fulfilled, they thrive, instead of, you know, I'm working just to live, or I'm going to be in this career for 30 years. I think the new generation especially are really thinking about work differently than anyone has ever.
I would put you in the new generation.
Yeah, that's great. It is interesting to hear you validate, I think, some of the things that we experience on a daily basis with the clients that we do work with. You know, supply chain issues and workforce, of course, are big topics these days. Frank, did you want to ask a question?
So just getting back to an earlier comment on process, you know, you go through the application process, you go through interacting with staff, you go through the approval by the committee. What happens, or what were your experiences when it comes to actually crafting the lending agreement, you know, through our lawyers and your lawyers? Could you comment on what that process was?
Gosh, how long ago was that? Our initial application, I would say, was very easy from there. You know, the term sheet was almost exactly what, you know, as you review the legal terms, it was exactly what was in the term sheet, no changes, no fluctuations, which doesn't always happen with VCs or other contracts that you're dealing with. And dealing, you know, I've dealt with a lot with Peter, who's great, who you guys use for legal, relatively straightforward. We have a lot of different sections of debt, so I think I have 4 or 5 different debt lenders that I'm also trying to negotiate, usually while I'm doing some SOFII funding. And on the SOFII side, it's been wonderful and quick, and I've had no issues with that part of the process.
Yeah, I'd say for me, it's been a while since our first agreement back in 2015, but I think it's largely stuck to the same similar, you know, structure. So it was fairly painless there. I think always for me, when I deal with our lawyers or other people's lawyers, it's always slower than I want it to be, but that's just maybe my personality more than anything.
I won't be able to comment because I think it was painless because I didn't do it. Dominic did it. So, but you know, the testimony, and we had the same thing. You know, you had other debt holders, and so you know, but it all worked out well. So I'm assuming, and you know, I'm assuming it all was okay. I'll ask Dominic and let you know.
Great, Todd.
Yeah. I think the panel showed that there's different utilizations and applications of the fund for different purposes, and it filled a real void. I guess it helped you attract additional funding, it helped you grow, that type of thing. So it seems the fund's performing as intended. I just wanted to put your comments about what if this fund didn't exist, and where would you be in your development now compared to where you were able to get be able to access the funding and do what you have done successfully?
That's a great question.
We would have had to pay a lot more for other debt. I think we would have got it, just a lot more. We would have had to give up a lot in terms. So when I was evaluating a bunch of different debt lenders, I think we would have got the money. It just would have cost us a lot. And there wouldn't have been that flexibility, I think, with, you know, during COVID when we delayed some principal payments, or, you know, we just upped our fund again. There wouldn't, you know, dealing with other lenders is not as easy, not as painless. So I think we would have found the money somewhere else, just had to pay a lot more and given up a lot more of the company in order to do it. So that would have stunted our growth for sure.
Yeah, I think for sure like that, you know, it could have been a different lender that was more aggressive with worse terms that would have hurt us in the long term. And at the end of the day, hurt, you know, the opportunities that we would have had in the long term, or forced us into equity earlier than we needed to, dropped our valuation, made it harder to find talent, and, you know, whatever. There's so many negative implications from that. So I think being able to stretch that as far as we can and make sure we're on a really nice growth path is important. So I think it was a pretty key element to getting us to where we are.
I think for us it would have been, in fact, we did get approached, so it would have probably been selling the company prematurely, we had been approached by strategic partners, not the one that actually invested in us, out of the US, and you know, it would have been where do we take more dilutive money or and expensive money, or do we actually sell? So it did serve a very useful purpose to let us continue to grow.
Great. Any other questions from the floor?
Tristan, were you aware that all the Olympians are here the last couple days?
No, that was random. I saw the sign.
Okay,
like, oh,
did you?
Well, I know a bunch of people down
We've
there.
All been kind of talking about it. I thought, oh, like, how funny is this? That we're very well timed. We did it on purpose, actually.
Thanks. I'm going to go sell next door once we're done here. So.
Excellent. Okay, so I don't think there are any other questions. So at this
let's go open it up as well to the online audience.
Thank you.
If you have any questions, you can either type them in the chat or feel free to unmute yourself and throw your camera on so that we can see your beautiful face on the TV here. All right. Donna, I see you here. Do you have a I think we have a question from Bob. Bob, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, having the SOFII funding, does that provide you any leverage in dealing with your other funders?
With SOFII funding, does it provide you any leverage with other funders? So is there, you know, any benefit?
Yeah, directly in that... you know, we would have not, because it gave us staying power as well. First, it helped us demonstrate the technology much better, as scalable. But, you know, when you have cash in the bank, regardless, and you've got a cash runway that is more than without the funds, you are able to get better terms. So it's 100% leverage on that front. And the other thing I would say is that, you know, we were able to also get a modest new line of credit with RBC as part of the whole thing. So it, you know, on two levels of leverage, I would talk, you know, okay.
Yeah, I was gonna echo that. I think runway is leverage. So for us, if we have more runway, we have more time to get the right terms that fit for us for maybe that next equity step. So yeah, that's always a key step for any debt for us, but that's definitely added to that.
Great.
Yeah, I would echo the same. We brought on Comerica Bank, which ranked first in priority over SOFII after SOFII. And SOFII was really great at just, you know, we were nervous that, you know, we wouldn't be able to leverage more debt after bringing on SOFII. But, you know, bringing on a first ranked in priority was easy. Bringing on someone who ranks the same in priority, so we did pari passu, was relatively easy. So in that front, I would say I was nervous with all the different debt facilities, but it was easy to do.
Okay, excellent. Any other questions from online? I can't see the screen.
We're just waiting to see if anybody else would like to submit a question either through the chat or feel free to unmute. In the meantime, do we have any other questions from the audience? Just raise your hand and we'll have a mic runner come around to you.
It's been really interesting to hear your stories and have you contribute today. It's been great.
Well, thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, no, thank absolutely. You. I'm just buying a couple of seconds here in case there's another question that comes through online. But, oh, great, Sarah's getting ready there. But okay, so maybe we'll move on. Yeah, thank you guys so much for your contribution. I think this has been it's been really interesting, and I think it really helps to validate for everybody in the room the importance of the fund and the program to businesses such as yours. And we appreciate your time. So thank you so much. And there is some seats here as well, if you want to come down and sit here. And we have another guest coming up here, which you might be interested in.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I think there's some seats. Are there some seats here, Arthur, if you're interested in sitting up the front or on the side? Okay, so just a very quick introduction to somebody else here. Chris Prendergast, who is also a SOFII client, is a musical guest for us today. And Chris, are you? Would you like to say something before you get started?
Hi guys. Yes, I'm gonna play some stuff, but I think it would make sense to talk a little bit about myself and the company. Obviously, I'm a client of SOFII's. They've been hugely helpful in helping to fund my business, which I will demonstrate in a minute. I am an engineer. I'm a teacher, and I initially solved my own problem. I was personally frustrated with music gear, primarily a guitar player. I actually built a device myself. It was a small amplifier, very similar to the one I'm showing you. This is actually our second generation product. So I didn't actually show anyone initially. It was something I enjoyed myself. And then became more and more kind of enamored with the idea as I realized how unique it was. Started to show some people, and there was a huge reaction. So anyway, my story kind of involved kind of fast-forwarding a lot. We were on Dragon's Den, which was a lot of fun. We raised some money through the York and Spark Angels and a few other angels in the area. I did crowdfunding, Indiegogo and Kickstarter actually, which helped us get to market with what we called the JamStack One. And we got some big patents, and it's been a really fun and interesting ride along the way. Transitioning into what we're about to release this year, you get to market with a hardware product, you obviously learn an immense amount of things that you couldn't have possibly known when you're initially starting out. But there's a really large gap between, creating your first attempt at market, learning everything you need to learn, maybe attracting some partners that are a little bit more advanced, have some more capability, more credentials behind them, and then being profitable, right? So that gap is quite large. And that gap from angels to VCs is quite challenging as well. But anyway, we just finished our production pilot actually last week for the product I'm about to demonstrate. And we've got a vision that's pretty ambitious with this hardware product and accessories, and we have some software that we have in the works as well. But feel free as I show you how this thing works and play a little bit of music just for a few seconds to. Ask any questions, and I'll be happy to answer them for you. All right. Okay. So as you can see, it actually attaches onto the body of the guitar. It doesn't need to. It's also wireless, so you can cast out to somewhere else in the room. You notice it doesn't affect how the guitar feels, on your body. It's not affecting the balance. It's got a number of things that are really unique. I mean, everyone can picture a guitar amp, I think. It's very heavy. It's not, doesn't connect to the internet. It's not very intelligent. And you can't even play music through it. There's a number of issues. But this thing is quite a bit different here. Thing about this is that it connects to your phone. So for example, one of the most fun and rich experiences on the guitar is playing along to music. So you'll notice what I'm doing as I hit this button at the back here. These are effects that I programmed into the amp earlier using one of our apps on our phone actually. So you can kind of mix it in and get a volume that makes sense. And then you can, pair here. There we go. It's fun to, thank you. It's fun to be able to enjoy your own product, to be your own customer, which is, I think, a huge advantage for us. And this is something that, this is a pre-production unit, it is production hardware. There's a number of improvements that that will be present in the mass production units in a month or so. I'll show you another example, and also integrate into the demo, I guess, some software that we're working on. So I'll change the effect here. So this is some backing track software. Works really great with our hardware, of course, but you could use it without. So I'm going to play. So this is your song you'll recognize, probably. We will rock you. This is software. What I'm going to do is take that out. So what I've just done is removed the solo from this song. So this is a music streaming platform, basically, but it's multi-track, which allows you to mix kind of music on the fly, which is a lot of fun. So kind of similar to the demo I showed you earlier, that song was on Apple Music. This is something that is on our software. Oh, we will. One second, it's a little. Oh, we will rock you. Yes, it's a lot of, you can match, where we're also working on, as soon as you get to a song, it'll actually match the tone that you have in your amp. So again, I would summarize what we're trying to build in two ways. One is we're working hard to remove every bit of friction there is between wanting to play your instrument and having a great experience. So that's setup time, that's how long it takes you to sound like how you want to sound. That's getting really good quality by again mixing in a lot of modern technologies, Bluetooth speaker tech, the sound processing chip that's in here, Bluetooth, how great phones are getting, 5G, all of that fun stuff, and then also adding the social element into everything. So if I were to describe the current state of what Fender and Yamaha and Marshall are making, it's that it's not social. It's not something that's easy to bring out into the world and share an event like this. I mean, normally you saw me, walk up here and start playing. Setup time is usually in the 20 to 30 minute range, especially if you're playing with effects and backing tracks and those kinds of things, which makes it antisocial. And also the ability, for example, these presets that I've crafted, you can text it to a friend. They can open it up on their phone and experience something that you've done. And with our software also, you'll be able to record your performances and share them with other people. So I'll just play one other thing and then be happy to take questions. So I'm gonna go into Apple Music here. I've been I've had enough, I've been fortunate enough to to, you know, test this out in the field by, you know, doing some small performances on, you know, pubs, balconies, those kinds of things. Let's see. Let's go with this one, I guess.
Or one time.
Love it.
I may have a friend who wants one.
Yeah. So, $369 US, which is about $470 Canadian for the speaker, which provides a ton of value because it's several kind of things all at once. I actually didn't mention one of its core features actually, and that's the fact that you can record into your phone. I mean, that's not by literally just plugging the cable that charges your phone. You can plug into the back of the speaker and open up any piece of software and actually record everything I was just doing right in the port, which is a lot of fun. The software is a subscription model. We're raising capital for the software right now on the equity side. So that's what's kind of holding up the release of that, I guess, but we're about 4 months away there. And then the hardware is, you know, it's primarily on our Shopify store and on Amazon, though we are going to be in Long & McQuaid as we were previously, and also Guitar Center. Retail takes a lot of kind of work. It's kind of high touch, but it's great for those customers that really insist on that experience and also the credibility that it comes with. And also next year we'll be kind of, you know, doing more of a push with some new hires, hopefully. Did I get to all your questions there?
Yeah, forgive the ignorance, but how did the Dragon's Den experience go and what happened?
Yeah, it was great. I had a great experience. We got a deal on air. So Michael Weckerly is a guitar player. He played the amp, and it was actually a prototype of our first gen, so it was quite a long time ago. I was really well prepared, and went really well. Actually, Jim and Michael both shook hands and gave me what I asked for. However, I hate bursting this bubble a little bit, but it is reality TV isn't quite reality. So, investments do happen. I've talked to a number, about 10 or so people that have been on the show. Only one of which actually ended up closing a deal. They tend to use a strategy where they really drag out diligence about 8-9 months in some cases to kind of cash in at a very different juncture on deal terms that were established a long time ago. Anyway, so we were serious about making the deal. Initially, they seemed like they were as well. We ended up getting investment through some advisors on better terms, and didn't end up closing the deal. Any other questions? Yeah. I think it's you.
Curious about licensing or music rights. So yeah. Obviously you're doing part of your own creation when you're playing guitar, but you're in some cases you're mixing it with the tracks of obviously established songs. So how does that work out, and what was that process like trying to figure all that out?
Yeah, difficult, for sure. It's a crazy space. Though, there was some good precedent. So the karaoke space has been doing this a little bit, right? There's a few apps where you can sing along to popular music, and you can discover other people singing along to other music. So that helped. The music that I was showing were not the original masters. Like, that wasn't actually Queen. We're working on that. That's a long-term play. The labels are very, very protective over that. So they actually don't have control over, like, so for example, labels cannot stop anyone from re-recording a song. You just have to pay them. So you have to pay them a 12% fee for a song that they own if you did the recording yourself. And then, so we have a rev share agreement with the master's holder that has all of those tracks. And then in the user agreement, it's kind of how you handle, I guess, the licensing of the artist that's, you know, recording and sharing it off into the world. Our hope actually is to start paying musicians, and again, with a bit of a rev share for music that they create that does well. That's a short version of it.
Okay. Chris, we'd just really like to thank you for being here.
Thanks.
Don't have the opportunity most for this live music stage in here, and thanks very much for coming. I'd also like to thank those who attended the meeting who are not part of the next meeting, which is the Board of Directors closed meeting, and thank you for being here, participating. Special thanks to Matthew for showing up for us again, and taking care of everything we need to do and the connection to make this work. So thank you very much. And I think then what we'll do is bring this to a close. We'll have 15 minutes break back in here at noon. Our lunch will be served at the back. It'll be a working meeting. And come prepared to work. Thank you.